As we have come into this place today, we've sang and we've played music, and those are all scriptural ways, and dance is another scriptural way of worshiping the Lord. It's in the book of Psalms, and so we want to just encourage you to be receptive to what the Lord has for us through this song, Alive and Breathing.
What holds your heart? What stirs your soul? What matters come to mind? The cares you keep, the thoughts you think. It's not all wasted time. Seeking you will find. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. We wonder why we lost our way from home. Our father finds the child inside. We left for growing old. Let everything praise the Lord. In the working, in the waiting, let it praise the Lord. In the blessing, in the breaking, come on, praise the Lord. In the dying, the rising, let it praise the Lord. Let it praise.
Pray to the Lord. Jesus, here we are as a family, bound together by our love for you and your love for us. And we are so grateful that we can come to you boldly in our time of need, finding mercy. And so, Lord, we pray one for another, especially with all the things that are going on throughout, not here in our community, but in our state, physically, Lord. This flu has really seems to be an epidemic, and there are some who've had to come down with it 2, 3, 4 times, Lord, and we're just presenting them to you. Lord, there are others who have either had surgery recently or facing surgery, or they've really received just a horrible report concerning their medical condition. We lift them up to you, Lord, believing that you are the great physician and you're able to do anything. And Lord, we also lift up our neighbors to the south of us in Parkland. Lord, our hearts grieve with them, especially for those parents and the spouses of those who lost their loved ones in a heinous act of evil, Lord, where they were taken from us, Lord, 13, 14 years old, 17 years old, Lord, and our hearts are grieved by it. We pray for our governor. We pray for our first responders. We pray, Lord, that you would give them common sense on how to protect our schools and how to protect our community, Lord. And I know there's a lot of rhetoric going on, but what we need is your wisdom, and we pray for that. And Lord, as we come to see your amazing ministry in our lives, we ask that you give us eyes to see and ears to hear and a mind to understand what you, the Spirit, would say to us, the church, and give us a heart to receive this glorious gospel, for truly it is glorious, and it is the power that transforms us from the inside out. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. We come to Luke's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 31, and it is a tale of Jesus' amazing ministry. Jesus' amazing ministry. Jesus has spent time in his hometown of Nazareth, which is to the north of Capernaum, and he went there specifically to preach the good news to his family and friends that he grew up with. He had a heart for his family and had a heart for his friends. The boys and girls that were now adult men and women that he had attended school with, had gone to synagogue with, had been there for the family celebrations and the funeral services and the weddings. He had gone there to reach them with the message of why he came. And we saw his heart break last Sunday because they rejected him and actually tried to kill him for what he wanted to do. And it picks up in verse 31. It says, then he, meaning Jesus, after leaving Nazareth, went down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and was teaching them on the Sabbaths. So Capernaum is a city in the area of Galilee. Again, it's like Nazareth in the sense that Judea and Jerusalem looked down upon the inhabitants of this area. They called it the Galilee of the Gentiles, not because it was made up mostly of Gentiles, but because there were those who were of mixed heritage there, and the elites of the city looked down upon those of mixed heritage in the rural area. But Galilee wasn't a rural area. There could have been as many as 2 million people in the region, with Capernaum, one of 240 cities in this area, had a population of about 10,000. That's a lot for that day, but 10,000 people there in Capernaum. And Jesus made the journey 16 miles south to Capernaum. And there it says that he did something that was his custom. He went and taught in the synagogue, and listen, don't miss this, on the Sabbath. Otherwise, it was the custom of Jesus to come to synagogue on a weekly basis and do what we're doing here today in the church, is making it a regular part of our worship to come together on the Lord's Day, which is Sunday. We're not Sabbath keepers. We celebrate Jesus, the resurrection on Jesus, on the first day of the week. And here we are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. Now, the synagogue was mainly for the teaching of God's word, and it was a time to go through the law, which is the first five books of Moses and the Torah, and then also the prophets. That would be Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, and they would do this systematically. And it was a little different than what we have today, because even their own rabbis said the typical synagogue service was dry as dust. It was very formal, you know, very, very formal, not a whole lot of joy. And most of the time people spent falling asleep during the service, listening to the rabbi, rather than being engaged in the word of God. No one ever does that here at Calvary, do they? No, we're all here. We're all here. But by the way, if you do fall asleep, don't worry about it. Jesus said you'll be the first to go in the rapture because the dead in Christ shall rise first, right? Then we who are alive shall be caught up together with them in the air. So here he is in the Sabbath, but he's not like any other rabbi they've ever heard. And he did this not on one Sabbath day, but continual Sabbaths. We don't know how many, but it says here in verse 32, this is why we know it was different. It says they were astonished at his teaching, for his word, and literally in the Greek, it was for the word, very definite article there. The word that he was delivering was with authority. The rabbi spent most of their time saying, well, this rabbi says this, and this scholar of the law says this, and this commentary on the prophet says this. But Jesus never referred to somebody else. He said, you have heard it said, and he would repeat what they said, but I say it was with authority because he is the living word of God. He was taking the written word, which is all about him, and he, the living word, was saying with authority. And it says that they were astonished at his teaching. Astonished means that literally he blew their mind. They were beside themselves. They had never, ever heard anything like this before in their life. And I love that about Jesus. Paul said it this way in 2 Corinthians. He says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is freedom. And that the Spirit of God actually transforms us from glory to glory. When Jesus is present, he's here, and he has transformed us from glory to glory. They were blown away by his teaching because he taught with authority. Now, this is about to be illustrated with him in a very graphic way, because it says here in verse 33, now in the synagogue, there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon. I don't know why Luke included unclean, because I've never met a clean demon. Have you? I have never met a clean. I've encountered demons personally a couple of times in my personal ministry, and neither one really just brings joy to my life, because you see how demons who work for Satan actually distort and disfigure and twist the creation of God. One time many years ago when I was in the Arica, Chile, which is the northernmost city of the desert in Chile, I was there for a youth conference, and I was one of the speakers there. And it was kind of a cool conference because they rented an adult theater to have their conference. And actually what they did is they actually covered up the pornographic, you know, signs of what took place there usually. And they came in, and there was about 800 from the area of Argentina, Paraguay, and Chile, and Peru. And they came there to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. And what was really cool is after each evening, they would leave the service and go out into the streets of Arica and have a parade proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ. It was really cool to be a part of. And I was so thrilled to be a part of that. But one evening before the service, a number of pastors pulled me to a back room along with the other pastors. I wasn't the only one there. And there in the middle of all these pastors was a young lady. She literally was on all fours, hissing like a cat at these pastors, and they were praying for her. It was something that is etched in my memory, looking at what Satan had done to one of God's creations. And the good news is that the Lord delivered her of that, and she was set free. Another time is with some of you here in the congregation. We were down in Tanzania, and we came across a man who had been possessed with the devil, and he literally all day long would take a pile of rocks and move it to another pile, going back and forth and back and forth. And when we encountered him personally, the pastor, Pastor James Mbova, brought him up to us. And when you looked in his eyes, the eyes literally were vibrating. He was barely clothed. Who knows when he had bathed, and he was possessed with a demon. And we were asked to pray for him. And then Pastor Mike DeSanza, myself, we prayed for him, and we found out a year later when we went back to that area that that man had actually been set free by Jesus Christ and began to share with others the glorious gospel of what Jesus did for him. And so there are demons in this world. So where do these demons come from? Well, we're told in Isaiah chapter 14, in eternity past. And it says this in Isaiah chapter 14. The writer says, how you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. And so here we have Lucifer, which we now know as Satan, who was an anointed cherub of the Lord. He was there as an angel, created being in heaven until iniquity was found in his heart. And he thought about attempting a coup on God. Never a wise thing to do. And so he attempts this coup. He said, I'm going to ascend to the throne room of God. And he said, I'm going to ascend above the stars of God. The phrase stars of God refers to the angelic host. And the Bible tells us later that a third of them joined Lucifer in this overthrow or attempted overthrow of God. So demons are fallen angels. Demons are fallen angels who rebelled with Satan. But I like this. He goes on to say in Isaiah, when he says, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, I'll be like the Most High, yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. I like that. God says, don't even think about it. Don't even think about it. And I like what Ezekiel says. Ezekiel says he takes Satan and violently throws him down to the earth. And so God is greater than Satan. And demons follow Satan. And are they at work today? Well, Paul says this in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. There are things that happen to us in our life that are just the normal chaos of life, the normal result of living in a fallen world, but not everything is flesh and blood. There are spiritual forces at work. And it says, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. There is a real persona of evil, and his name is Satan. And there are demons that work under him to bring about chaos in the world and to try to thwart the plan of God. But greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Amen. And so here you have this man who is possessed with this unclean demon. And by the way, I just want to go ahead and say, set the record straight. This man's not a Christian. This man's not a Christian. First of all, Jesus hadn't risen from the dead yet, so the church has not yet been born. But there is no way possible throughout Scripture, and I'd be love to discuss this with you. It won't be an argument, but it is just a truth that Christians cannot be possessed with demons. It's virtually absolutely impossible. First of all, God's not into time sharing. God doesn't say, okay, Lucifer, you can have 3 weeks of Kevin's life, and I get the other 49 weeks of Kevin's life, or you can have a couple of hours a day. I want Sunday, Lucifer, and you can have Monday through Saturday. God doesn't do that. The Bible tells us over and over again in the New Testament that when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit seals us, marks us until the day of redemption. And no one has the right to revoke or break open the seal that the King has established. So this man is not a Christian. But that doesn't mean that every man or woman that comes to a church service is not dealing with a demon. You must be born again. And so here you have a man who had an unclean demon, and he cried out with a loud voice. So Jesus is teaching, and all of a sudden, the demons within this man provoke him to cause a scene. How do you know what's of God and what's of the devil? I'll tell you what's of God. Everything that points people to Jesus is of God. Anything else, whether they point into themselves or to another man or to another work, is not of God. The ministry of the Holy Spirit, he says, my ministry, we're told this about the Holy Spirit. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is not to point people to himself, but to point people to Jesus. And so here you have a man with an unclean demon, and he's provoked to cry out with a loud voice, saying, let us alone. Literally, in the Greek, it is the Greek two letters, A and E, which we get the word, ah. And this is what it sounded like. So Jesus is teaching, and all of a sudden we hear this, ah! What have we to do with you, Jesus, of Nazareth, did you come to destroy us? The answer would be, yeah. Yeah, absolutely, right? Demons recognize, and they say it, that he is the Holy One of God, that he is Messiah, he is the Anointed One. And they ask the question, have you come to destroy us? The word destroy means to ground to powder as if it never existed. Jesus said this about Satan and about himself in John's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 10. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. John writes of the ministry of Jesus in 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. It says, for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. That Jesus has come to annihilate not only Satan, but the works of Satan, to crush to powder as it never existed. Satan works in the lives of people. He causes them to do things that are against the law of God, the moral law of God. He twists the nature. He twists the truth. He lies, he deceives, he steals, he kills. But Jesus says, I have come to give you life. I will destroy the works of Satan in your life, and I will make you a brand new creation. The old will pass, and behold, all things have come new. Jesus Christ goes on to say, and I give you this authority, my dear church, to call upon my name. Call upon my name, and I will destroy the works of Satan. Call upon my name, and I will heal the sick. Call upon my name, and I will comfort those who are mourning. Call upon my name, and I will point them in the right direction. Jesus is close as a mention of his name. When you see the works of the devil, do not fear, church. Call the name of Jesus. He is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He is the mighty one of God. Death could not hold him. His body did not decay, but he rose up on the third day and ascended to the right hand of the Father and lives to make intercession for his beloved church. Amen? I like that. Jesus didn't break his rhythm. Jesus didn't break a sweat. Jesus didn't get caught off guard. You don't see Jesus teaching, all of a sudden this demon says, what do we have to do with you? We know who you are, the Holy One of God. And you don't see Jesus saying, I didn't see that. You ever feel like something happens in your life and you wonder if God knew that was going to happen? The answer is yes. When God told Moses about the children going through the wilderness, he told them, he said, I will go before you. There's nowhere you'll go that God hasn't already been. I'll prepare the way before you. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has been to our tomorrows. He was there in the past, and he's with us today. Jesus cannot nor ever be caught off guard. And I love how Jesus responds to him. There's no sweating. There's no wrestling with. There's no arguing with. There's no negotiating with. But Jesus rebuked him. That's it. Jesus rebuked him. And the word rebuked means in the act of this demon spewing out this horrible thing toward God, spewing it out in the midst of him doing this, Jesus simply said, he said, be quiet and literally be muzzled and come out of him. That's it. So the devil is active and at work, and Jesus simply says, be muzzled. I don't want to hear it. I do not care what you have to say, and come out of him. And not only was it just one demon, it is numerous demons, because they said to Jesus, did you come to destroy us? Us. Plurality. Demons in this man. And Jesus simply said, be quiet, come out of him. Again, no wrestling, no perspiration, no threat, no negotiation. It's simply the name of Jesus. Demons have to flee. The kingdom of God had come. The light of God had flooded that little synagogue there in Capernaum. and demons cannot be where the light of God is. And when the demon had thrown him in their midst, so here's what's going to happen. Now the demon is going to throw a hissy fit. It's going to throw a temper tantrum and throws this man into their midst. Now that'll make for an interesting Sunday morning service. Going through the teaching, and for those who are half asleep thinking they're going to the rapture first, and all of a sudden someone screams out, "Ah! What do you have to do with us? We know who you are. You're the children of God. And we have the authority, and I would say even the responsibility to say, be quiet. Come out of him." And the demon throws them into the midst. It means into the midst of the people. And it says here, it came out of him and did not hurt him. Don't you love that? The thief comes to steal, kill, destroy, but I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. This, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Now here's something that seems to be an understatement, verse 36. Then they were all amazed and spoke among themselves, saying, "What a word this is! For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out." Now, what they were used to were exorcisms. There was plenty of commentary on how to exorcise a man or a woman of a demon. We don't know how successful they were. So it was not someone who had a demon that they were unused to. They were not unused to someone trying to exorcise a person of a demon. Acts chapter 19, we're told about the seven sons of Sceva, who was a high priest. They had been watching the ministry of Paul. The Bible says that God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, that even the handkerchiefs that were cut from his apron were taken to people who were sick and afflicted, laid it on top of them, and they were healed. That's something extraordinary that God did. And the seven sons of Sceva said, "Oh, that's pretty cool. Let's try that." So they found this man who was possessed with the devil, and there's seven of them, and they said, "We command you in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, to come out." And the demon, who's intelligent, says, "Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you?" And beat them and stripped them naked and humiliated them as they fled. So they're used to people trying to exorcise them. What they weren't used to is Jesus. Jesus is our big brother, and he carries a very big stick. And he's willing to face the bullies of our life, demons and Satan himself, and he will not negotiate. He will not be intimidated. He simply rebukes them and commands them to come out. What a word this is. For with authority and power, he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out. And verse 37 says, "And the report about him, went out into every place in its surrounding village." When he had come and began his Galilean ministry before he came to Nazareth in Luke chapter 3, it says that news about him spread about. The rumor of him, the rumor of the miracles he did, the rumors of the healing and deliverances he did. But now it changes. Instead of just being a rumor, that says the report about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. It actually is the Greek word echos, which we get the word echo. His name echoed throughout the region, and better translation, his name roared throughout the region. The Son of God had come. The kingdom of God had come, and he was in their midst, and his name roared throughout the community. And I like that. You know that Jesus wants to roar in your life today. He wants every demon and Satan to know, and every work against you to know, that he is here in our midst. And all we have to do is call upon his name, and he will roar in us and roar through us. Amen? Are you facing darkness today? Are there things that cannot be explained? Are there phenomena happening around you? Are there things that you're dealing with and you know they're just not normal? It's not just a washing machine breaking down, or a belt in your car, or the cable not working, which is of the devil, by the way. The cable not working, but there's something else going on. There's something that's happened, a series of things that happened, and you realize this is beyond natural explanation. There's something supernatural going on, and it can bring apprehension, it can bring fear, but Jesus says, "Don't worry about it. I'm here to roar in your life. I'm here to speak into your life. Ask me, and see if I will not destroy the works of the devil in your life. And it says here, after this public ministry of Jesus, it says here in verse 38 that he now arose from the synagogue and entered into Simon's house. This would be Peter's house. Peter's house that he shared with his wife and his mother-in-law and his brother Andrew and his wife. And they had a fishing business with James and John, and it was a very lucrative business. This house was about 100 yards from the synagogue. So this is the Sabbath day. It began early in the morning for them, and they go to Simon's house for, I guess, Sabbath supper. You know what we call Sunday lunch, Sunday supper. And there they are in Simon's house, Simon Peter. And it says here, but Simon's wife's mother, he was married. I want people to know that Peter was married. There's some people who didn't think Peter ever got married. It says here that Simon's wife's mother was sick with a high fever. Yes, Simon Peter was married. And she was his partner, not only there in the home, but even in the ministry and mission of Peter. We're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5, when Paul is speaking, he speaks how the other apostles and their wives and Cephas, which is Peter and his wife, traveled about doing the ministry that had called them to. Peter's wife stuck with him all the way to the end. Church tradition teaches when Peter was in the dungeon, the maritime prison of Rome, that right before he was crucified, they brought his wife before him and crucified her in front of him, trying to get him to recant. Now, tradition says that Peter's final words to his wife were this: remember thou thy Lord, O woman. And only a man would do that. That's a man's attempt at trying to bring comfort to an impossible situation. Not that I love you, honey. I'll see thee on the other side, or hang in there. Remember thou thy Lord, O woman. He must have been a warm, fuzzy type of guy, right? And it says that she was crucified in front of him, and then he was crucified upside down. So Peter was married, and his wife was a partner in this life and in ministry. And it says here, there, that his mother-in-law was sick with a high fever. It is more than likely a life-threatening fever. She was convulsing from this fever because a low fever was considered malaria. So this is something that is worse than malaria. And she is dealing with this, and I like this. And they made requests of him concerning her. This is Peter, possibly Andrew, maybe Peter's wife, Andrew's wife, and all those who had come over to the house to have a meal together. They made a request of him, being Jesus, regarding her. Listen, when we have someone that is sick, and it might just be like a migraine, or it might be what we call a common cold, or something like a high fever that is life-threatening, we who are healthy need to take those who are sick and bring them to Jesus. Don't you agree with that? I know you do. And we shouldn't let anything escape us. They couldn't do anything for her, so they brought her to Jesus. This week, when President Trump, and speaking of the tragedy in Parkland, he invoked the scripture from the life of King Hezekiah, and I love this. It says that Hezekiah was given a death sentence from the Lord. Isaiah was given the assignment of telling Hezekiah to get his affairs together because he was going to pass. And the Bible says that Hezekiah began to weep bitterly before the Lord, and the Lord's response, I have heard your prayer. I have seen your tears. Surely I will heal you. And I think that's why we should bring people to the Lord. Those who are weak in their body, those who are down and afflicted with sickness, and even when it's the common things, things that we feel like we can just take for granted and deal with, that we should take it all to Jesus. Why? Because Jesus says, don't miss this, I have heard your prayers. I have seen your tears. And I will heal you. How could you resist that? Jesus hears our prayers. Jesus sees our tears. And he said, surely I will heal you. We're told in Mark chapter 5 about Jairus, who was a ruler of the synagogue. And quite possibly, it was the synagogue where Jesus had been teaching. Because it's there in Capernaum, and he came to Jesus because his little daughter, who was 12 years of age, was lying on the bed and dying. And this is what Jairus said to him. Jairus begged him earnestly. That word earnestly means with intensity. It means actually point of laboring to the point of perspiring. He's laboring. He's intense. He is fervent. It's like the heating of a furnace saying, my little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hand on her that she may be healed and she will live. There are things that happen to us in our life and sometimes words escape us, but there's an intensity. There is a furnace inside of us that we are to take that to the Lord and to pray. When Peter was put into prison, it tells us in Acts chapter 12, verse 5, that constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Peter is in prison. Jairus' daughter is on the bed dying. And Jairus fervently prays to the Lord. The church constantly prays for Peter, who's in prison. The word constant is the same root word that we get the word fervent. There was a furnace inside the church. There was an intensity inside the church. They lifted up Peter to the Lord, and it was constant. It was constant. We are to continue bringing our needs and our petitions and supplications to the Lord for ourselves and for others until we are assured and that we know that we know that God has heard us. And how do we know that? Because the Bible says, and God shall give us peace which transcends all understanding. Sometimes it is a healing. Sometimes it is a peace that God is sovereignly in control of the situation. One more, Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is the pastor of Colossae, was sent to Paul there when he was imprisoned in Rome. And Paul writes a letter to the Colossian church. And he says, Epaphras, who's one of you, a bondservant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently. The word labor means to the point of exhaustion. There is some prayers that bring you to the point of exhaustion. And for us who do pray for people, you know, whether it be a spouse or a child or a loved one or a friend, you know how exhausting it is as you see that person laboring under what is afflicting them, as you see the life ebbing from their body, as you see them trying to hold on with the will that God has given them in this life, and that this is laboring to the point of exhaustion fervently for you and your prayers. He's intense about this. He's laboring. What? So that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. So there is laboring fervently for the Lord for those who are in prison, laboring fervently for those who are afflicted, laboring fervently for those who are being discipled and conformed to the person of Jesus Christ. Let me ask you something. Are your prayers fervent? And that's not to make any of us feel bad. It's to cause us to do a self-examination. You would agree we live in chaotic times. You would agree that there is a devil. You would agree that he's come to steal, kill, and destroy. And we would also agree that Jesus has come to give life and life more abundantly. May our prayer life in these last moments of these last days be fervent. May it be a furnace of the fire of God inside of us, going to God on behalf of our own needs, but also on the needs of others. And doing it to the point of exhaustion. Lord, if you don't move, this is what's going to happen. Lord, we need you to heal. Lord, we need you to strengthen. Lord, we need your wisdom. Lord, we need you to do this. Lord, if you don't do this, this is what's going to happen. And the Bible says this, I've heard your prayers. I've seen your tears. And I will heal you. Listen. Every one of us who are sick will be healed. The only question is not if you will be healed, is when you'll be healed. Is either on this earth, which by the way is temporary, and then there is the eternal healing of being taken to the presence of the Lord. I like that. And it says this, so they made a request of him concerning her. So he stood over her. That is a term of what a physician does. Luke, being a physician as well as a historian, uses this to say that Jesus took the stance of a medical doctor and stood over her. But that is the last place that has any reference to a physical doctor. Then say, hey, take two of these. Call me in the morning. You know, here, make sure you drink plenty of chicken noodle soup. Tried to stay bundled up. He didn't give her Augmentin. He didn't give her Bayer aspirin. Didn't give her something for her. Didn't give her Thermoflu. It says he rebuked the fever. Again, this is in the aorist active tense, meaning that the fever was active. It was working feverishly inside the body of Peter's mother-in-law. In the midst of this activity, he spoke. This is interesting. He spoke directly to the fever. John Phillips, in his commentary, said, we don't know if he spoke to the virus or spoke to the bacteria, but what we do know is he spoke and the fever heard the master speak and it left her. I love that. So he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her. Why do we bring people to Jesus? Because he stands over them, rebukes the fever, and it leaves her. And immediately she rose and served them. Now, Ruth and I are no different than anybody else in here. We have gone through the flu season. And thank you, Jesus, we don't have the flu right now. But I can tell you something, after dealing with the flu, Ruth and I dealt with it for days, and it seemed like weeks, it seemed like years. We were dealing with it, and I tell you right now, after breaking the fever, I didn't do what this woman did, because it said that immediately she arose and served them. Otherwise, she got up and made them a meal. She got up and went about her responsibilities as a host with Jesus in the house. And Jesus, when he heals completely. Don't you love that? And he does a work, he does a good work. And she got up and went about serving. And I believe that Jesus is here today, and he wants to heal us not only physically, I believe that, but I also believe that he wants to heal us of those things that hinder us from service to him. There are things that maybe beyond your control, or maybe you can't seem to work your way around about something the Lord has called you to do. And Jesus says, why don't you just let me touch you? I will rebuke that thing that's hindering you. And then I want you to get up and I want you to arise and I want you to begin serving me in the area I've called you to serve. I love that about the Lord. He is beautiful in all that he does, and he does it for us. Amen. And it says here, when the sun was setting, so what we have here, when the sun's setting, early in the morning, he was in the synagogue, public ministry, and then he goes into the house of Simon, which is private ministry, and now he comes out into outside Simon's house, into the yard, which we could call, again, public ministry, not in the synagogue, but in the street. Don't you love that about Jesus? When you spend the day with Jesus, you see that he's at work in the church, he's at work in the home, and he's at work in our public life. He's with us when we're at church. He's with us when we're at home. He's with us when we're working or somewhere in the community or on vacation, wherever our feet may carry us. I love that about Jesus. And he's as close as the mention of his name. And it says that when the sun was setting, all those who had any that were sick with various diseases brought them to him. Otherwise, the roar of Jesus was getting around. Demons being cast out. Peter's mother-in-law being healed. They brought them to him. I love that. Again, bringing people to Jesus. In Luke chapter 5, we're told this incredible encounter of Jesus speaking in this very home, and that people were filling the house, and people were sitting in the window sills, and people were in the yard, and it was quite a scene. In fact, there were so many people there. Mark's gospel tells us that Jesus' mother and his brothers came there, thought that Jesus had gone insane. They thought he had gone insane because there were so many people there. And they were trying to get him so they could have treatment for him. Literally, that's what they were going to do. They were going to take him to have his head examined. It seems silly to place our faith in Jesus, does it not? It's foolishness to those who don't believe, but we who do believe, it's the power of God. It's the power of God into salvation. And so here they are everywhere, and I love that. And it says that the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And then, behold, men brought on a man who was paralyzed, whom they sought to bring in and lay before him. So these four friends, Mark tells us, have this paralytic, which is a friend of theirs. They put him on a stretcher, I guess, a cot, and carry him for Jesus to pray over. But they couldn't get in the house. They couldn't even get into the front yard. There's people everywhere. They're sitting in the windowsills. They're sitting in the house before Jesus, but they would not be dissuaded. Listen, there are many of us here who have family members and friends who need a personal encounter with the Lord, but there are so many obstacles in the way. There's so many things in the way. These friends would not be dissuaded. It says, and when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, listen, people always try to keep you from Jesus. You know that. They went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling into the midst before Jesus. When he saw their faith, he said to him, man, your sins are forgiven you. What a beautiful, beautiful work of our amazing Savior. When we have friends that are afflicted with disease, when we have friends who are being depressed by, or in some cases, possessed by the devil, bring them to Jesus. There are many obstacles between them and Jesus. Don't be dissuaded. We can pull down arguments through prayer. We can see blinded eyes open spiritually through prayer. We can see hardened hearts soften through prayer. They brought him to him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. Wow. And demons also came out of many, crying out and saying, you are the Christ, the Son of God. And he, rebuking them, did not allow them to speak, for they knew that he was the Christ. Matthew tells us that Jesus doing this was a fulfillment of Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4, where Matthew says it this way. He cast out spirits with a word and healed all those who were sick, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, he took up our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. The word infirmity means that Jesus wants you to give him your pain. Peter said this way, casting all your cares upon him because he cares for you. Jesus wants us to either bring the pain of people, our own pain, to him. And he also wants us to bring him our sicknesses, our diseases, those afflictions that trouble us so much. Do you have pain today? Do you have physical pain? Is your heart broken? Do you have mental anguish? Jesus said, bring it to me. Bring me your pain. Bring me what ails you, and I will heal you. I love that about the Lord. No ands, no ifs, no buts, no conditions. Simply, it is an act of faith. Listen to me. We hear a lot today about you've got to have so much faith to do this. You can't move mountains without faith. It is an act of faith to go to the Lord in prayer. It might just be a small amount of faith, but Jesus said, that's okay. Mustard seed faith can move mountains. The very act of going to Jesus in prayer is enough, and he's pleased to do it. Don't let anybody ever make you feel bad because you don't see the answer you're seeking. Just keep trusting Jesus. Trust him in the morning, trust him in noon, and trust him at night when everything seems to be worse. And by the way, the Bible differentiates, and we see this right here, between physical ailments and demonic works. And even mental health issues. In Matthew's gospel, we're told that there were men who were lunatics. They literally had a mental disorder. And the New Testament differentiates between those who have bodily afflictions, those who are dealing with demons, and those who have mental health issues. Ultimately, all sickness and mental health issues are the consequence of living in a fallen world. Yes, Satan can, you know, work with those things and make life even worse, but not everything is a devil. Not every sickness you have is a devil. The Bible seems to differentiate between them. They were sick with various diseases, brought them to him, and he laid hands on every one of them and healed them. And demons also came out of many, crying out. But what we're to do with our mental health, and we're hearing a lot about that, especially with the school shooting recently, about mental health disorders. Some of it can be demonic, but there are those who literally have, for whatever reason, whatever physical deficiency or whatever has happened in their life, they have mental health issues. We are to give our mental health issues to Jesus. We are to give our sicknesses to Jesus. We are to give the afflictions we have because of demons to Jesus. He said, bring your pain to me. Your physical pain, your mental pain, your spiritual pain, bring it to me and I will carry it for you. It is so easy to get to the point of wanting to give up. But that's where faith does come in. Faith means to simply to trust Him and to keep on trusting Him, believing that He is who He says He is. Now it goes on to say here in verse 42, now when it was day, so this is now, he's early in the morning, he was at the synagogue. He moves to Peter's house, and at nighttime is when all the demons are going to come out again. There's something about nighttime that's just hard to deal with. But here it is, in the morning, Mark's gospel tells us it's before the sun rose. Now it was day, he departed and went into a deserted place. A deserted place, a solitary place. Now I'll tell you something, and you guys know what this is like. It's not just pastors who deal with this, but it's just Christians. There are certain things that we deal with after a trying day. It has more to do with a job. It has more than doing just the schedule of running, you know, the kids here and kids there, having to pick up grandkids. It's more than just all the things we have to take care of. There is a spiritual exhaustion that takes place, especially for those who are interceding for others, especially for those who are concerned about their loved ones and their spiritual condition. You're totally physically, emotionally, mentally, and yes, even spiritually drained. And what we'd want to do, and I wouldn't be any different, and let's take the day off. Let's go do something different. But what did Jesus do? He got up before sunrise, departed, and went into a deserted place. Mark said, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place and did what? And there he prayed. Luke 5, he often withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. Luke chapter 6, verse 12, he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. Luke chapter 9, verse 28, he took Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. So Jesus went to a solitary place that he might get alone, not with his thoughts, but with the Father, to see what the will of the Father was, to also be refreshed by God, to be strengthened in his inner man by God. Remember, Jesus is fully God, but he's also fully man. He got tired. You know, he was exhausted. He would be hungry. He would be thirsty. And yet, instead of laying around, feeling sorry for himself, or laying around and doing nothing, he got up and spent time with God. That is the secret of the success of Jesus' early earthly ministry, but also the secret of success for us as believers, especially in the last moments of the last days. Things are getting intense. We know that. Satan's like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour, going to and fro on the earth, because Satan knows what some Christians don't know. Jesus Christ is coming soon. And he's doing his best to continually blind people to the glorious gospel of Jesus. And if they've come to Christ, then to sideline them. And it says that he went out there to pray. Now, I like what Luke 8 says, Luke 9, verse 29 says. It says, as he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. I like that. It's an encounter for us with the risen Christ, that he refreshes us. Our countenance will change. Our thoughts will change. And even though we'll be physically drained and maybe even physically sick, our inner man is alive and vibrant and strong and ready to meet the challenges of the day. And it says, and the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. So here he is trying to get on an alone moment, me time. And here comes Peter and the kids. We're told in the other gospels that Peter actually led the crowd to find out where Jesus was. And there, thousands of people are crowding them. And it says, and they came to him and tried to keep him from leaving them. And I like this in verse 43. But he said to them, I must preach. The word must is an imperative command. I must preach. preach, I must proclaim the kingdom of God to the other cities also, because for this purpose I have been sent. Mark said it this way, for this purpose I have come forth. And what Jesus is saying is, I who was alive in eternity past and communed with the Father in eternity past, I have come forth into the world to proclaim the kingdom of God is in your midst. And that the light of God has come to dispel the darkness. He said, I've healed you, I've delivered you, but my purpose on this earth is to proclaim the kingdom of God. And I have come that you might hear the good news. And ultimately, that's why Jesus has come. Because it goes on to say, in closing today, in Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4, it says, he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. Otherwise, he carried our pain and he carried our sicknesses. But he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. By his stripes we were healed is talking about the spiritual healing of being forgiven of our sin and the power of sin being broken over us. He carries our physical pains. He carries our physical sicknesses, but he has come to heal man of the sin nature. So two things for application for us, and then we'll pray. Jesus said this, and I think this is for every one of us in this room today that have been born again. Behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. You have been given the authority, the same authority that Jesus manifested in our text today is the authority that he gives you. Delegated power. Jesus freely gives his power to his church to confront Satan and to confront the consequences of people living in a fallen world. What does that mean? The second application, James chapter 5. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed his sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer, there it is, of a righteous man avails much. Let us, with the authority that Christ has given us, pray for one another. And continue praying for one another. Not only for the physical things, which are very important to the Lord, but also for the spiritual condition. For those who are in sin, that they will be delivered from sin. For those who are saints, that we would continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Let us be like Epaphras, who continually fervently prayed for his church, that they would grow up into the perfect will of God. Amen? As we pray, right after we pray, elders and prayer partners will be here in the altar. If you're sick today, or if you know someone who's sick, make your way up here after we dismiss, and they will pray with you and anoint you with oil. And the Bible says that the Lord hears your prayers, and the Lord sees your tears, and the Lord will heal. Father, we love you, and we thank you for what you're doing in the earth today. We thank you for our amazing Savior. We thank you for Jesus, who's as close as the mention of his name. What a beautiful name that is. What a wonderful name that is. You've done so much for us, Jesus. You have saved us. You've healed us. You continue to heal us. You delivered us. You keep us safe from the power of the enemy. And you've given us the authority to do great things in your name and for your name's sake. Thank you for that, Lord. We love you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing. God bless you guys.
Let's stand to our feet. Sing this blessing to one another. May the grace of the Lord be with you now and always. May you stay blameless till he comes. May the love of the Lord be with you now and always. May you stay blameless till he comes. May the grace
of the Lord be with you now and always. May you stay blameless till he comes, blameless till he comes, blameless till he comes. And all God's people said, amen.